Inflation has reached another record-breaking point. As a matter of fact, it is again broken the record of another four-decade year-long high. The CPI, the Consumer Price Inflation Index, at 7.5%. But what does that really mean? In this video, I'm going to break down what the numbers are. More importantly, I'm going to break down what the numbers aren't. What they're hiding inside of this data that really shows what the real number is, how looking at CPI is the completely wrong way to be looking at inflation. I want to show you what the Fed may be doing about this, what they're saying, but more importantly, what they're going to be doing, and of course, what you should be doing and expecting because of this. We're going to jump into this real quickly, so let's go. All right, real quick, if you are new to the channel, my name is Mark Moss, and I make these videos to change the way you think about money, because almost everything you have learned is wrong. And today is a perfect example of that. The Fed, the BLS, the Bureau of Labor Statistics, has put out the new CPI numbers for us. And again, it's broken another record, a four-decade year high, broken the record that was placed last month. And while it's bad, it's really bad, 7.5% inflation, the numbers are actually much worse. And so we need to understand what the real numbers are and how they've lied. Of course, I call CPI, I call it CP lies. It's nothing but political propaganda. Now, what happens is, if you don't know, is they track a basket of goods. So in 1980, I went to the grocery store, I bought a basket of goods, steak, milk, cheese, eggs, bread, etc. And then over time, they track that same basket of goods to see how those prices increased. The problem is a couple things. One, they've continually changed the CPI basket. In the 80s, they rewrote it. In the 90s, they rewrote it. They're talking about rewriting the way they calculate that again today. If we went back to the way they calculated that basket back in 1980, it would be a totally different story. The number would probably be 15% or more. But even that doesn't tell us the real number. So first, let's jump in and take a look at the headline. Let me pull up my screen here. As you can see here on Yahoo Money, we see inflation reached a 40-year high, which is a January CPI post a 7.5% annual gain. Again, 7.5, that's what they're telling us. I'm gonna tell you what that data really means and, of course, why that data is wrong. What we can see here is this represented the fastest rise since 1982. Wow. As well as an acceleration from the 7% year-over-year increase seen in December. So that was what I said last month was a record-breaking month at 7%, and now we're 7.5%. So on a month-over-month basis, consumer price increased by 0.6%, matching December's rate. You can see it in a chart here. So here we are back in 1980, where we got as high as 14%. That's when CPI inflation was really, really high, and some very extreme things were done to try to fight that inflation and bring it back down into normal levels, as you can see. And then inflation has been kind of trending down, and here we are hockey sticking straight up again. Now we can see here a couple things that are important. So energy prices remained a key contributor to the overall CPI, and we're up 27% on a year-over-year basis in January. Energy, like things like oil, gasoline, the thing that's probably the most important thing for everything, because if you want to go to the restaurant, your food needs to be delivered there. Employees need to drive to work. You have to drive to work. Your clothes need to be driven to the store, need to be flown from the factory. And so energy sits at the base of everything. We can see fuel oil prices jumped 9.5% on a monthly basis, 10% month over month, which is insane. We can see gains in food also contributed to the headline. But I want to dig in right here. All right, because this is the really big piece. Shelter prices. Shelter prices, another primary contributor to inflation gains in recent months. So home prices are through the roof again. Now, they don't count home prices. There's a couple things in here. So first thing, they don't count home prices, but they say shelter prices are up 3% on a monthly basis. It led to a 0.5% increase in rent prices. Now, why do I say rent prices? Because if we jump over here and we can see, this is the report from the BLS. I'm on the BLS.gov website. And how is the CPI measured? We want to understand that. And more importantly, the owner's equivalent rents of primary residence. So they don't track the price of the home. So for example, if your home goes from $200,000 to $400,000, that would be a 100% increase in the value of your home, but they don't track that. They track what's called the owner's equivalent rent. And so that means, forget the price of the home. If you were to move out and you wanted to rent your home, how much would that rent go for? So that's what they do. And so it says right here, if someone were to rent your home today, how much do you think it would rent for monthly, unfurnished and without utilities? And they basically take a poll. They go ask. The following questions asked of consumers who rent their primary residence are the basis of the weight for rent. So they're just running a poll. Who are they polling? Did they ask me? I didn't get asked. Did they ask you? So who are they even polling to get that answer? It's pretty interesting. And here's why this is important. In the CPI for all consumer, CPI-U for all urban consumers, there were 24, almost 25% respectively, the weighting. So this rent piece equals 25% of the total score of the weighting of the CPI basket. But how do they get that number? They ask homeowners, but I didn't get asked. Did you get asked? No, neither of you did. Now, is this number true? So remember, they told us that it led to a 0.5% increase in rent prices. Really? Let's take a look at that. So I jump over here. I'm on rent.com, and you can see here on rent.com, rent report for January of 2022 for last month. And it says a monthly look at average rent prices across the United States. And here we are, national average rent prices. And you can see here that nationwide rent prices for both one and two bedroom apartments have increased significantly year over year at 22% and 18% respectively. So, rents are up 22%. They're saying 0.5%. And remember, that rent equivalence makes up 25% of the weight of the basket. As a matter of fact, we can see here a one-bedroom apartment is up 22%, two-bedroom is up 18.3%. Now, what's cool about this is you can see state by state how much they've gone up. And check this out. Here we are, Arizona, 53%. Rents are up 53%. That means if you used to rent for $1,000, now you're renting for $1,500. We can see up here, Idaho, 60%. You can do the math. If you were paying $1,000 for a month, now you're paying $1,600 for the same place. California, 21%. Over here, we can see Florida, 45%. So it looks like Idaho's really winning the race here. And then if we want to break that down, that's state by state. And then if we want to look at cities, we can see here city average rent. So the following cities experienced the biggest increase. So Gilbert, Arizona is up 117%. So if you were paying $1,000 a month, now you're paying over $2,000 a month. Jersey City is up at almost 40%. Now, what's interesting is these are the following cities that have experienced the biggest declines. So Toledo, Ohio is down 23%. We see Cleveland, Ohio is down 4%. And so Gilbert, Arizona is up 117%. Toledo, Ohio is down 23%. So what you can see here is that the CPI is a CP lie. The data is completely manipulated to show you what they want. They didn't run the data that's apparent right here on rent.com. So that's the first thing. Like I said, if they would adjust this for the national average of about, 22%, and that's 25% of the weight in the basket, that would probably push the CPI up to about 15% right off the bat. So it's not 7%, it's 15%. But here's why that number is completely wrong anyway, why that number doesn't mean anything. So you can't measure inflation with a single number like that. The economy has, in the United States, over 330 million people, but there's trillions of data pieces that affect things. So for example, supply chains are responsible for inflation, sure. So gas prices are responsible for inflation, sure. More money being printed is responsible for inflation, sure. But the way that this inflation rolls out is different. So let me give you an example. Well, here's a perfect example. Gilbert, Arizona, it went up 117%. Toledo, Ohio, it went down by 23%. So to say that inflation is 7% across the board is completely ridiculous. You can't measure trillions of data inputs with arithmetic with a single number. You couldn't measure the wind drag coefficient over a jet with arithmetic. Inflation isn't prices increasing. Inflation is the monetary supply increasing. So if I had a balloon and I increased the volume of the air, I would inflate the balloon. Right? Now, if I were to increase or inflate the money supply, I'm inflating the money supply. So it's the money supply that inflates when the Fed pumps more money into the economy, balloon. It's inflation of the monetary supply. The prices are the effect or the results of that. And so when they've printed or created or inflated about 35% more volume, more dollars, more money into existence in the last 24 months, about 35%, then we see the results of that are Gilbert, Arizona rents going up 120%. Toledo going down by 23%. I have a friend that bought a house on Lake Travis in Austin, Texas for $10 million a year ago, just sold it for $25. That's a 150% increase. But not every home in the United States went up by 150%. Different things go up differently. It all affects us differently. If I am renting a place in Toledo, Ohio, my cost of living went down. That's great. If you're in Gilbert, Arizona, your cost of living went up. And so to try to say 7%, first of all, it's a lie, CP lie, it's manipulated. But second of all, it doesn't really matter to you and I. What we want to look at is what is the increase in the monetary supply, and then what are my buying things? If I have to send my kid to college, if I have to buy a home, it's going to affect me differently than if you're living in a basement watching Netflix and living at your parents' house. And so you need to understand the differences. So when the Federal Reserve, when the central banks increase the monetary supply, that is inflation. And here's the problem. When they've put in, between the Fed and the government, have put in about $8 trillion in the last 24 months, they inflated the money supply. When you inflate the money supply, then things go really well. You lower interest rates, people buy more goods, people buy more products and services, businesses pick up, there's more money going around, businesses are expanding, they're buying new equipment, they're buying new trucks and vehicles, and all those things because of all that money. But then the Fed comes out and says what they're saying now, which is, inflation's too hot, so now we're going to raise rates and suck the money out. And now they want to suck the money out, and now all that new business that was created because of that stimulus goes down. Boom, then bust. Boom, then bust. The Fed puts money in, boom, the Fed sucks money out, bust. They have completely messed up the cycle. If we go back here and finish out this article, we see here inflation and the Fed. For investors, the latest CPI serves as a key update as to whether inflation has continued to run hot enough to justify a quicker shift to more hawkish, more hawkish monetary policy from the Federal Reserve. The Fed's dual mandate dictates promoting both maximum employment and price stability. So this maximum employment, these are the two things the Fed is supposed to do, maximum employment and price stability. So maximum employment, so they say that unemployment is back to historically low levels. Really? Because in my town, I can drive up and down the street and almost all the shops have signs that they're running limited hours because they don't have enough people. There's help wanted signs everywhere. Nobody can find enough people. I've even seen signs online of shops shutting down completely because they don't have staff to run. The reason, just like the CPI, is they've continued to change the way they calculate it. Really, if we calculate it back the way we did 30 or 40 years ago, we probably have 25% unemployment or more. And then the second one is price stability. And of course, when rent prices are up 117% in Arizona, I wouldn't call that exactly price stable now, would you? So when we go down here, many market participants are now bracing for the Federal Reserve to begin raising interest rates from the current near zero levels starting in March. So we got about a month. Supposedly they're going to do this. They're going to not only raise rates, but it says here seven rate hikes throughout the year. Fed officials themselves have suggested a less aggressive path forward. So when the Fed announced they were going to begin tapering and raising rates, the market starts selling off. As a matter of fact, they talked about this in November of last year, which of course corresponds with the peak of Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies back in November. When it turned out that all they were doing was talking and didn't really do anything, then it seemed that the market started turning back up a little bit. I would expect that, and as I've been saying this a long time, the Fed is stuck. The Fed is stuck between a rock and a hard place. If they continue to print money, inflation will continue to run hot. If they taper the printing, then the markets will crash. They don't want either one to happen. I would expect they're going to continue to jawbone. They're going to continue to talk about this without really doing anything. They can manipulate and move the markets by just talking about them. Maybe we get a quarter. Maybe we get 50 basis points of a move. That's about all I would expect, and I would expect this to continue. But what do you think? Do you think the Fed can really stop buying or stop pumping money into the markets by next month? Down to zero and start raising rates this year? Is that what you think? Leave me a comment and let me know what you think about that down below. Of course, as always, give me a thumbs up on this video if you like it. You know I'm working hard to bring this data to you. If you don't like it, you can give me a dislike. Of course, I can't see your count anymore because I don't know why. I'd like to see it, but give me a thumbs down. That's okay. But give me a comment and at least tell me why. Tell me what I got wrong. Give me your opinion. I'd love to discuss it with you. And that's what I got for you today. All right. To your success. I'm out.